Good afternoon, everyone. Jim Dougherty here again, Senior Fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations. And today we're doing another session of our roundtable on technology innovation and American primacy. We have an exciting event for you today. We're also going to do a little experiment. We've never done a poll as part of our roundtable, though I think as many of you know that polls are very popular across the council. So we're going to do our first poll today. The topic that we're going to be talking about today is reimagining foreign policy, U.S. foreign policy to meet the challenges of strategic competition. And we have two great speakers, Earl and Carolyn, and their CVs are linked. Just a reminder that, again, this, unlike most of our meetings, this one is on the record. So this will be recorded and be available for people afterwards. So with that, I'm going to introduce Earl to walk us through the poll and begin his presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim. And a special thank you to Lila, research associate, and all of the people who've been involved with this. And I believe, Jim, I think you've done 140 of these meetings.
Yes.
So we're very thankful for your exceptional leadership. So I wanted to start, when we talk about American primacy and innovation, I think it's critically important to understand the importance of how parity plays between the United States and countries like China. You saw this parity in particular in the 1960s when China strived to be a nuclear power. Today, China has roughly about 1,000 nuclear warheads in its arsenal. You saw this parity take place in the 1980s with China striving to be a military, with China striving to be accepted into the World Trade Organization. And you are now seeing this parity take place in today with the realm of 5G and big data. I first had the opportunity to travel to China in 1998 as a junior at the College of William Mary, where I studied at Beishida, Beijing Normal University. I was on a foreign dorm with 20 other students, and we had one phone for all 20 of us. And I remember having to wait an hour to call my sister, who had just given birth, and speak to my little nephew and hear his voice for the first time. Roughly about 20 years later, I am on a high-speed rail train from Beijing to Hangzhou, and I'm using the Wi-Fi on the high-speed rail that is getting beyond the Chinese firewall, and I'm using a phone that is being produced in the millions throughout multiple provinces in China. And so when I think about parity between the United States and innovation, I think that that's critically important to understand. With that, we're gonna show a poll. Lila, if you can go ahead and start the poll. We'll go ahead and talk. We have a few questions in the poll, but myself, Jim, and Carolyn will continue to have a conversation. And please, when we have about 90% participation, we will go ahead and go through the results of the poll. So Carolyn, I know, you know, we're excited. Oil and energy needs. Carolyn, what would you say are some of the salient components that you're seeing right now with respect to oil and energy security?
Wow, Earl, well, thank you so much. A very big thank you to the Council on Foreign Relations and to Jim for having us. It really is a pleasure and a privilege, so I'm very grateful. Well, I'm gonna be talking a little bit more about oil and gas in my comments, but you know, clearly oil energy security has catapulted to the forefront of most people's, you know, reading of the headlines in light of Russia's invasion of Ukraine. And I think this is an area where the United States is already using its abundant natural resources as a potent instrument for its foreign policy.
I think one of the things that I think is also important when we look at this critical geopolitical inflection point is how the United States has also been working collaboratively with a number of its partners to look at you know, both military and economic resources, and how that those could potentially be strained by having both, you know, a short-term adversary, which would be Russia, and then a long-term adversary, which would be China in the future. And I think the being able to have a straining of those ties, both military and economic ties, is something that's critically important as well. Carolyn, I know in your book, you talk a lot about this jackal. In our book, we talk about this concept of a jackal and Hyde. Can you explain those concepts and what they mean?
Sure. So when I, in this book that I was fortunate to be an author in, the book that Earl edited, From Trump to Biden, Reimagining U.S.-China Relations, my chapter on energy focused on energy statecraft. And I, brought up this idea that China is both a Jekyll and a Hyde, because it is of course, largest consumer of coal. 60% of its energy mix, it comes from coal. However, it is also a major exporter of renewable energy technologies, battery technologies, many of the things that are really important for the world's achieving net zero. So this idea that they can be both the largest carbon emitter in the world, but also a very significant supplier of the components of the energy transition.
Great. We'll give it another 30 more seconds, and then we'll go ahead and start the poll, okay, and go over the results. I think one of the other important aspects of, utilizing this poll is just get a sense of what our audience is thinking on these critical issues. I wanna be cognizant of people's time. So I think, Lila, if that number has been stagnating, I think it's go ahead, it's fine. We can go ahead and start the results of the poll now. Allow me to go through the polling questions. So the first question is, what issue are you most concerned about in US-China relations? We have a number of people, an overwhelming majority said 36%, the stealing of intellectual property or cybersecurity attacks. That's interesting. Historically, when I've, we've done about 47 of these with our book talks, and mostly the vast majority have been a potential military conflict. So that's very interesting. For question number two, how confident are you that the United States can bring back some manufacturing jobs to the United States? An overwhelming majority, 68%, said somewhat confident, okay? Question number three, can the United States compete with China in manufacturing by the year 2030? An overwhelming majority, 36%, said maybe. Question number four, do you believe China will be the strongest global economy in the world by 2030? An overwhelming majority, 36%, said no. And I think that's quite interesting. Historically, when we've done these polls, for about the first 4 months that we did our book, the vast majority of people said yes. So I think some of the perceptions of China have changed with the significant pandemic that has really caused lockdowns in China and also caused significant has. Question number five, in the light of current events and Russia's invasion of Ukraine, how do you view China? An overwhelming majority, 63%, said as a potential adversary. And I think that's important because when you look at the historic polling, Gallup did an interesting poll. If you trace public opinion of how Americans have viewed China since 1970s to today, we are at one of the lowest points in US public opinion of China. The only time public opinion has been lower has been during the Tiananmen Square, Tiananmen Square incident in 1989. Okay, wonderful. All right, with that, Lila, can you go ahead and start my slides? And we'll start with the first slide. So From Trump to Biden and Beyond was published in September of 2021. What's unique about the book is that there are 13 authors altogether. There are 10 chapters. Our first chapter looks at the critical role of how the United States and China both redefine both competition and cooperation through manufacturing, tech, and innovation. That really defines and sets the tone for the first chapter of the book. We also look at China's economic engagement in regions such as Africa, Latin America and the Caribbean, the Gulf states. We also look at critical issues such as cross-strait relations. What's also unique about the book is that it is written, and if you look at the total number of 13 authors, collectively we speak about 7 different languages. And we have really tried to highlight authors and perspectives, authors from Taiwan, diplomats from Japan. So we're not getting just a kind of US-centric perspective. Next slide, please. When you look at the critical role of competition between the United States and China, I think that clearly China's economic growth and development is a clear driver behind this competition. Most people, when you look at China's economy and the landscape of China, China's historic is broken up into kind of tiers. Most people are familiar with tier one cities, Beijing, Shanghai, Guangzhou. What has been fascinating with China's evolving economic ecosystem is the fact that China has now even come out with tier two cities that have graduated into tier one cities. So there's something called new tier one cities, such as Nanjing, which is also being placed in that category. China grew about 4.8% in this first quarter. And I think it's critically important to understand that the most economic growth and development in innovation has been occurring in the tier two cities. And that has been happening for the last decade. Next slide, please. In our book, one of the things that we highlighted was the critical role of how both US soft power versus kind of China's soft power. And so we counted every single consulate and embassy on the State Department's website, and we compared that to the number of embassies and consulates in China. And what we found is that within the last 5 years, from 2016 to 2021, there's been an increase in China, about 6.4% of Chinese embassies and consulates. At the same time, we've seen a corresponding 7% decrease in the number in the United States. So we had a high, China now has 284 embassies and a combination of embassies and consulates, which is the highest number of any country in the world. And the United States currently went from 271 to 252. What has also been interesting is the United States has also developed the number of virtual diplomatic consulates. So for example, these in many ways reflect the kind of creativity of the United States on how it competes with China in the diplomatic realm. We have virtual offices, virtual embassies in countries like Iran, as well as in San Marino. Next slide, please. In terms of investment, one of the chapters that we highlighted, chapter two, looks at the critical role of Chinese investment in the United States. And roughly 41 companies most recently have been delisted off US stock exchanges. And these are important as important sources of revenue for the US economy. But if you look at the total number of volume, both between the United States in China, just in terms of global economic inflows and outflows, is roughly worth about $4 trillion. And so these companies such as Huawei, if you look at the vast majority of the companies that have been delisted, roughly 29 or about 70% of those have all been located in Beijing and represent state-owned enterprises. Next slide, please. In terms of U.S. capital investment in China, what we've seen in the year 2018 was really one of the highest points of U.S. investment in China. You saw roughly about 500 transactions worth over $24 billion. And I think one of the critical takeaways here is that no other country than the United States has a vested interest in China for over the last 20 years. The significant economic growth and investment has been critically important, but you've seen by 2020, pre-pandemic, you see that number has been declining. Next slide, please. So this is an interesting heat map, which looks at how the pandemic has impacted China currently in 2022 versus 2019. And the key takeaway here is that in terms of mobility, you know, when you had the shutdown, lockdowns in Wuhan, which has roughly a population of about 11 million, when you see the global financial center of China, which is Shanghai, being shut down, the population of 26 million, it has a really crippling impact on China's economy. And I think that, you know, when you couple that with global supply chains, coupled with the fact that they're roughly about 40% of China's economy is currently in shutdown, something like 24 cities are currently in lockdown. This has a huge impact for China's economic implications, particularly as you think about potential future variants with China maintaining the zero COVID policy. Next slide, please. One of the interesting things I've been speaking the last several days with colleagues in China, and I spoke last night with one of my former staff when I worked at HSBC Bank. And China has declared that there's been no deaths from COVID. But what you've seen popping up on various social medias are examples where that has clearly not been the case. You'll see pictures here. These were banners that were put up by local Chinese and then were quickly taken down, but people were able to take pictures, put them on social media, and they went viral. I was speaking to my colleague yesterday, and the amount of anger that I saw in his voice of how the Chinese government has handled this really speaks volume to how the dissatisfaction of so many that are grappling with these very draconian lockdowns. There's even a Twitter hashtag that says Leave Shanghai. I was looking at another survey from That's Shanghai, which is a popular online media, and they did a survey that said 85% of expats in Shanghai are currently reconsidering their future in Shanghai. That is a staggering figure. I went to Shanghai first when I worked there from 2006 to 2010, and it was really the heyday of being in China. I mean, both foreign companies and foreign know-how were valued in so many different ways, and so to actually see what's happening now is something I never would have imagined. Next slide, please. So what are the key takeaways? I think number one, the future of U.S. manufacturing, I think, has critical implications for things like semiconductors. China accounts for roughly about 60% of the global demand for semiconductors, but only produces something like 13% of the global supply chain. And so I think that when you see companies like Intel announcing that they're going to invest something like $20 billion, in producing new chips in Ohio, I think these are great for American jobs and American competitiveness. But we're going to have to do more in the eras of research and development. I think another critical takeaway is with respect to global supply chains. The quintessential lesson learned that I'm hearing from a number of companies in China is that they are seeking to place a lot more assets outside of China. In the event that future lockdowns were to take place. Also, the China plus one model has been going on for a number of years, but I think that is going to further accelerate in the future with more investment going into countries like Vietnam, Indonesia, et cetera. And last, I think one of the critical takeaways is that with the Russia's invasion of Ukraine and U.S. troops going to be stationed in NATO and in Europe for the foreseeable future as a short-term adversary, and then China as a long-term adversary, I think one of the critical implications is that this is going to significantly strain both economic and military resources of the United States. And with that, that's my presentation. Thank you.
Okay, great. Well, I will jump in. Well, Earl, thank you so much for that. You gave us a lot to digest there in terms of what's happening in China and implications for the United States. So for the next 5 or 10 minutes, I'm just going to go through a couple of things that I've been thinking about when I think about U.S. competitiveness, focusing specifically on what I call energy and climate statecraft, also looking at the critical issue of critical minerals and supply chains and the role of universities and national labs. And I will point out that Jim is actually sitting in MIT in a classroom, so he has a great, great board behind him, which really does, I think, bring home the importance of US universities when we think about national competitiveness. So on the energy climate statecraft front, the U.S. is very well endowed with natural resources. We have seen over the last 10 years, the United States has become both the largest natural gas producer as well as the largest oil producer. And most recently, in light of the Russia's invasion of Ukraine, the United States has been able to sort of tap that abundance, bringing more natural gas online, asking U.S. oil producers also to increase production. We're going to probably see by the end of 2022 or at least 2023, the United States will probably be the largest exporter of liquefied natural gas, surpassing both Australia and Qatar. That's quite significant. Much of that is, you know, due to, you know, significant technological investments and innovations that we've seen. Many of you, I know, that are on this call are familiar with fracking, but that, of course, you know, really did create a significant energy revolution in the United States that, as Megan O'Sullivan, who's at Harvard University, has told us, is also a really important instrument for U.S. foreign policy. I don't think that, you know, energy and climate statecraft have to be dueling ideas. I think the fact that the United States does have a lot of natural resources can be used to the country's advantage, both economic advantage as well as national security advantage. But at the same time, the United States is a significant producer of the of renewable energy technologies, and I think we could be doing more, that we can, you know, create better pathways, both investment pathways, as well as reduce regulatory hurdles for the United States to be able to export those technologies. That's one of the things that we have seen, you know, China doing, that China has been able to take advantage of its sort of dominance in the critical minerals, rare earth space. Many of you will probably recall just in the last couple of weeks, the Biden administration has invoked the National Defense Act of 1950 to increase the production of critical minerals in the United States, really with the specific intention of saying, you know, if we are going to achieve net zero, if we're going to really decarbonize our economy and help other economies do that, then we need to make sure that we have reliable and affordable access to the minerals that are so important for that. And I think, you know, something that is important also for us to recognize is how we've seen in the 6 weeks since the invasion of Ukraine, how a ongoing dependency can really sort of create significant disruption. So if you think about a counterfactual, that I've, you know, posed to my students, that if in 2008, when Russia invaded Georgia, if at that point they had started to wean off of Russian energy, where would they be today in 2022? Much less dependent, there would be much less of a energy crisis that we are seeing. And I think that that, I mean, holds a lot of lessons for the United States in its own sort of dependencies around supply chains. I think on the subject of supply chains, there are lots of opportunities to enhance innovations, to enhance efficiencies. In the lead up to the holidays, many of us saw the myriad of photos of the ports of Los Angeles and the ports of Long Beach with significant shipping delays and log jams. And, you know, a lot of that could be and can be, and I think will be, diminish some of those inefficiencies by bringing more technological innovations into how we manage our ports. We see that in many countries in Asia. Not only are they running 24 hours a day, the ports are in operation 24 hours a day, but there's a lot of technology that's used in the whole processing of goods and supplies that are coming into their ports. So these are things that I think are sort of somewhat low-hanging fruit for the United States. The Biden administration has already said that the ports of Long Beach and Los Angeles will start to work 24/7, but many of the other ports in the United States still generally work 16 hours. So I think that, you know, aligning more with the operations, the global operation of ports, can also make the United States more competitive and also can bring down prices for consumers. You know, on the supply front of critical minerals and rare earths, something that I think is really important. And, you know, Earl gave us a lot to think about with regards to China. But, you know, China has been able to use its, you know, power in its own rare earths and as well as critical mineral, both production as well as processing, but they've also been able to, for example, around nuclear energy technology. So just recently, China signed an $8 billion deal in Argentina. This is, you know, kind of following what Russia also does is build, own, and operate model. They are involved in Chile, in Chile's national transmission grid. They have very significant holdings in what is known as the lithium triangle that encompasses both Chile, Bolivia, and Argentina. You know, and again, I think these are, you know, places where the United States can be doing more. Just last week, Secretary of the Treasury Janet Yellen suggested and made a, you know, call for the United States to do more friend shoring. And this idea that, you know, we should be looking around at our allies and at countries that can support U.S. competitiveness, but that can also support their own national competitiveness, and where we can sort of have advantages in the production of these resources that we so desperately need. So I think the issue of supply chain resilience, you know, speeding up the deployment of green technology both here and abroad, and, you know, and also streamlining the permitting process, both for, you know, energy projects that can bring more renewable energy to the United States, but also that can bring more, and something that the United States has not done in a long time because we're 50%, you know, dependent on imports of our critical minerals. But under this new, you know, bringing back critical mineral mining and manufacturing, how we can do it in an environmentally sustainable way. But again, I do think it's an opportunity for the United States and for US manufacturing and for competitiveness. And then, you know, finally, I am sitting here at New York University. The U.S. university system is a global powerhouse of intellectual prowess, intellectual capabilities, tremendous research that we have across our universities. So I think, you know, tapping more into our universities as well as our national labs, I think we all should sort of recognize and acknowledge the tremendous advantages that our 17 national labs across the United States that they provide in both, you know, the scientific research that they do, in the innovations that they bring to the market. Many of the innovations that we, you know, we now take for granted in our daily lives had their start in a national lab in the United States. So I think that's a great place where we can also see, and we do see, some wonderful sort of public-private partnerships, how we can further enhance those public-private partnerships, and, you know, what we can do to again, as much as we possibly can, sort of recognize where there are bottlenecks and how we can best address. Because again, I think when you're in competition with a country like China, which in many ways has the advantage of being able to eliminate those bottlenecks, partially through their state-owned enterprises, it can be seen as a disadvantage for the United States. However, I would prefer the compliance and I would prefer the adherence to environmental and, you know, not in any way diminishing standards, but at the same time, you know, making U.S. manufacturing and U.S. companies as competitive as possible. So I know that, Jim, you have a couple of questions for us.
Yes. And so after I ask a couple of questions, we're going to open it up to the membership. So please get your questions ready and then raise your hand. I think there's actually, and then I can call on you in the order within which you raise your hand. It's much easier doing it this way than in a big room where I have to try to memorize everybody's name. A couple of questions. Earl, I know you showed a chart that showed that the venture capital investment from the United States into China has been declining. But given how capricious over the last several months, their version of capitalism has gotten even worse, right? With the shutting down of the tutoring companies, they couldn't make a profit, and the gaming limitations and what they did to Alibaba. Do you see the not only American investment in China, but because of this change in their the way they're running their country, do you see a diminishment of global investment in China?
This is a great question, Jim. And I think absolutely. I think one of the key lessons learned when you look at surveys from the European Chamber of Commerce and others is that the vast majority of the companies, foreign companies in China, are looking to decrease, you know, investment in China. The question that I always get often is, you know, could we see, you know, in the future, once China gets a handle on COVID, would investment come back to China? And I think that really depends on a number of critical factors. One being, you know, is really the political question, right? I mean, how much of President Xi has really owned the zero COVID policy, and to what extent, you know, would he be willing to dissolve or move away from that policy? And so I think that's a critical piece of the equation. To what extent do companies feel that, you know, there won't be future shutdowns in the future? You know, when you see the number of people that are leaving Shanghai, and not just foreign companies, but average Chinese citizens who want to leave as well, and immigrate to other countries, either nearby China or to the United States, et cetera, I think this is cause for significant concern.
Jim, if I could just add, I would, of course, I think what we're seeing with regards to sort of China's handling of COVID right now is cause for concern. But I think the bigger issue is what we're seeing with how many Western countries have responded to Russia, right? In terms of, you know, very quickly issuing a whole range of different sanctions. And, you know, China's actions, right? We, you know, China does not have a clean record on human rights. We have the issue of, you know, of a potential threat against Taiwan. And I think, you know, companies are going to be much more careful about their investments in and with China because of that, because they would not want to be found, you know, in that having their operations be significantly disrupted. So not a complete decoupling, but I do think that there is more concern about the, and I think on the China's part as well, I think, you know, China is also more concerned about seeing it be entangled in the United States in the event that that there might be more sanctions that would impact China.
Thank you. Question for you, Carolyn. You had mentioned something I didn't know. I mean, I knew that the United States is not able to produce all of its rare earth minerals that it needs. And you said we have about a 50% market share. So we produce 50% what we need. Is that, did I understand that correctly?
Yeah. So we're about 50% of the critical minerals are in fact imported. In some cases, depending on the mineral, in some cases, it's actually more.
Right. So maybe you could just embellish a little bit more on that, which is that what are the most prominent things that we're doing now to address that, to eliminate our ability to be held hostage by countries like China?
Sure. No, I think that's a great question. I think we're seeing some really interesting things coming out of the Department of Energy. We have a loan program. We have something that's called the Advanced Technology Vehicles Program as well. In the most recent America Competes Act, the increasing the amount of mining, manufacturing, processing of critical minerals is built into that. I think, you know, we're looking at, you know, where we can trade more, for example, with Canada, which is a big producer of a lot of critical minerals. But again, kind of going back to that, you know, again, the Russia example, just as, you know, we've seen for Europe oil and gas, but also, you know, nickel, for example, there are so many different mineral resources that Russia is a very, very significant manufacturer of. And I should add, I mean, I didn't say it in my comments, but I think there's also, you know, an opportunity for not just the U.S. agricultural sector, but for the U.S. agricultural sector to help other countries, because we are seeing really, you know, tremendous food insecurity. We're seeing that, you know, where a 12th of the world's calories come from, you know, Ukraine and Russia. And when that, you know, when we have that kind of a shutdown, what that means for countries' economic and political stability and food security. So I think the United States can kind of take these multiple sort of crises that we're experiencing right now and look at them and sort of say, how can the United States, you know, better support countries that are in need in terms of both agriculturally, with, you know, US farm goods, but also US technological advancements.
Great. Okay, good. We have a couple of questions. Okay, so Stephen Pei, I think.
Yes. Thank you for inviting me. I think the question I have, I think Carolyn touched on that. Maybe actually, Jean, you are in the perfect spot to respond as well. I think Carolyn touched on the Great American University. As you know, that recently there are great concern about the China initiative and how the chilling effect impact on the science and the technology community across the country. Faculties all across the country, from Berkeley, Stanford, to MIT, to Yale, all voice concern. And we actually have petitions from over 200 universities across all 50 states and Washington, D.C. and Puerto Rico to appeal to both President Biden and also Attorney General to do something about it. I know there's a conversation going on with the Office of Science and Technology Policy, and there's an effort going on to cool down those chilling effects. But what happened in the recent years is These are the scientists the Chinese government have been trying to recruit for years unsuccessfully because they do not want to leave the US to work full time in China. What we have done in the past two, three, 4 years was we help the Chinese government to accomplish what they cannot do by themselves. Anybody have any comment on that?
Well, I mean, I have one quick comment, and I work with a lot of international students. Some of them are from China. And a lot of my students would like to stay in the United States, right? They'd like to, you know, they're not looking to immediately go back to the United States. And I know Jim has covered this in other roundtables, but, you know, I think we could do more to retain and keep really exceptional talent, both talent from China, and not incentivizing them to go back, right? And also to make sure that, you know, we're competitive on this, you know, on the science front, to make sure that, you know, we are offering our scientists, you know, those that are at the forefront of, you know, really tremendous innovations and new patents. I know that there was, you know, that there's a lot of IP theft that China is involved with, stealing U.S. patents and the like. You know, I don't want to see racial profiling happening on the, on this front. But at the same time, I think we, you know, there's a couple of different instruments that we could use, both in terms of keeping really tremendous talent here in the United States, but also making sure that, you know, China can't poach our scientists.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think in that sense, I think in the private sector or federal lab, I cannot speak for that. Let me focus on in the academic. So far, the track record for academic is very, very poor because all the conviction we have are just manual paper workforce. They are not espionage. They are not IPCF. They are not economics espionage. So the net effect is we're losing people. We know several people that have been recruited by foreign countries for over 10 years. They did not want to go, just like what you said. Many want to stay in this country as I do. I came from Taiwan. And my choice to come here to stay, I graduated, worked for Bell Labs. Then before I moved to academic. But what happened was the recent investigation pushed these people to leave this country while driving the talent out of the United States. Yeah. And what really created a chilling effect to discourage people to come, the talent student to come here. The research lab in the university is having a hard time to recruit good students now.
Yeah, I would just add, just in terms of the numbers, I mean, we have roughly for Chinese students, there are roughly over 290,000 Chinese students kind of pre-pandemic that have come to the United States to study. In terms of American students studying in China, there are roughly around 10,000 American students, and that number has been declining over the last few years. But Stephen Pei, to answer your question, I think you're absolutely right. I think the issue of discrimination against a number of high-profile cases involving Asian Americans have been a huge setback. And have been very unwarranted and you know, very, very, and it's been horrible for America, all, you know, as a whole.
Okay, just a reminder, we have another question, but please, members, just raise your hand to ask a question. We have about 13 minutes left. I'm going to try to pronounce this correctly, Moshumi Khan.
Perfect, actually, yeah, Moshumi Khan. So I'm a lawyer, and I have a quick comment and a question. First of all, this has been a really fascinating panel, thank you. I advise companies that source from Bangladesh, particularly in the ready-made garment sector, and so I can very much vouch for this China plus one. I see what an impact it's had, certainly in the RMG industry over the last several years. But my question is actually regarding U.S., maybe not policy, but local, basically our national context. I'm on the advisory council of the Asian American Foundation, And it's really been quite disturbing to see the rise in anti-Asian hate. And so what I'm wondering is, to the extent that even the survey that we did at the beginning of this session today, what impact do you think there is on some of this rhetoric as well as reality on rising anti-Asian violence, whether it's in New York City or, you know, throughout the country? So I'd love to get your sense of foreign policy having implications and rhetoric on local hate crimes.
I'll go ahead and start. Mushami, I think that is an exceptional question. And I think that, you know, when you look at the perceptions of, you know, if you look at the current geopolitical inflection point that we are in right now, when I saw the data that US perceptions of China are as, I mean, we are not as low as during the Tiananmen Square massacre, but just above that in terms of, you know, the, you know, perceptions of China, that should just kind of tell you where we are. And when you couple that with the rising notions of popularism as well as nationalism in both the United States and China, I think it's critically important that is having an impact on the anti-Asian hate, you know, that is fueling some of that, you know, hate against Asians. And I think that that's something that is clearly substantiated in a number of articles that have been written by a number of scholars. And I think that one of the ways that provides an outlet for more trust and more understanding is enabling more Americans from all spectrums of society to be able to study abroad. I would love to see more Americans at the high school level study abroad, also at the college level. And I think when you're in an environment where you are the minority, where you're learning about another culture and you can come out of your comfort zone, it gives you an ability to really engage with a culture that is really unique. I took two high school students who were from the Dominican Republic, from Spanish Harlem, my local high school, to Asia. And, you know, for them to spend 2 weeks in Taiwan, you know, in many ways changed their lives. And they were able to have a connection with people from China and from Taiwan. That is something that's very unique. So thank you for the question.
I was just going to add, I mean, Mushimi, it's a great question. I would just add that I think, you know, sometimes we do fall victim in terms of this narrative, this very much us them narrative, which of course creates this what we have seen, right, in terms of this anti-Asian hate, which is just awful, right? It's a blight on the United States. You know, I think we can be doing a lot more in terms of like US Asia writ large trade. I mean, one of the things that I didn't really sort of discuss in my comments is that, you know, as much as we talk about strategic competition with China, there are like significant opportunities for a lot more cooperation because we do have, you know, parallel objectives. So when we're thinking about climate change and, you know, how do we reduce global emissions, if the United States and China are not working together or not working sort of towards the same goals, then, you know, it hurts all of us. And I think there are, you know, tremendous opportunities for the United States to do much more with countries like Bangladesh, with Sri Lanka, with India, that I think, you know, should be very much sort of put more at the forefront of how we sort of talk about our foreign policy and what we can do, not only for our own national security and competitiveness, but how we can also help, you know, developing countries.
I'm going to ask another question. So related to your answer just now, Carolyn, so Earl, you would mention in your presentation, you know, the dependency that we've had, the United States, on the supply chain in China, and how it could be threatening to us to be dependent on that. We recognize that, but how realistic is it that by partnering with other countries that are allies of ours, that we can actually rebuild this supply chain in a, you know, in a profitable, competent manner, lowering our risk from being in China, but building it with other countries that are allies, whether it's Vietnam or Cambodia or European countries or Latin American countries? Is there enough there that we can extricate ourselves substantially from China and build a supply chain that works?
I'll go ahead and start, Carolyn. I think that there are significant ways where we are engaging with other economies, such as Thailand, such as Vietnam, such as Indonesia, particularly as you look at our new Indo-Pacific strategy. I think that is part and parcel of trying to redefine different types of global supply chains that mitigate the kind of placing too much of our eggs in one basket. I mean, I think that is one of the quintessential lessons learned from the pandemic. And we've seen this with the China Plus One strategy, that there are ways that companies are coupling new types of technologies to be able to produce goods and services. Chips are just one example in Taiwan, but also reshoring those back to the United States. So I think that there are creative ways that we are engaging with other countries to do this.
Carolyn, do you want to add anything?
Yeah, no, I would just, you know, what I said earlier and I'm just sort of echoing what Janet Yellen said last week about this friendshoring, you know, this idea that we can, you know, look at our supply chain, where there are vulnerabilities, like in some areas. I think that, you know, China has become our supplier of so many goods. And in the event that we ever had to quit abruptly, it would be amazingly disruptive. So I think we've seen that, right, with Russia as well. So how do we sort of look at our, you know, look at other countries that can, you know, that we work with. So it doesn't have to be only like America first or America only, but how do we, you know, better engage allies in other countries in addressing sort of where some of those critical supply chain vulnerabilities are.
And Jim, to your point, if I could just add one other thing, I had a meeting with the Semiconductor Association in Washington, D.C., and the reality is, you know, we're never going to be able to reshore, a vast majority of products and services. But there are things that we should be able to focus on, in particular, semiconductors as well as pharmaceuticals. I think those are two areas where we should be able to have more focused concentration and more of a focus on.
Excellent. So we only have another minute or so left. Any other questions from the membership? All right. Then I guess what we could do is maybe just closing comments. If you just want to, Ray, you always come through. So Ray, he's probably attended more than half of my meetings in the go ahead, Ray.
No, great. No, thanks. Thanks for the discussion. My name is Ray Harris. I work at the U.S. Department of Defense. That's my affiliation. And I just have a from a personal question referencing, you know, we were talking about supply chains and such. Are there other areas of engagement that the U.S. and China can have that is not strictly, you know, great power competition? You know, I don't want to get too nerdy, but, you know, realist, you know, strain of international relations, you know, balance of power and stuff. Are there other areas that either of you could see that could work for both countries? Thanks.
Ray, thanks for the question. And absolutely. When we talk about this quite a bit in our book, one of the quintessential areas where the United States and China should be communicating and engaging more is in the area of international narcotics. There's a huge issue of, I think there's a lot more we can be doing on that front, number one. Number two, I think there's a lot more that we can and should be doing on, like I said, on educational exchanges. These are win-win situations. I think particularly at the high school level, you know, I would argue. Other areas that I think that we have not really fully explored is in the area of international health. You know, I'm reminded at the pinnacle of the Cold War between the United States and the Soviet Union, you know, both the United States and Russia couldn't agree on who should have nuclear weapons, but they could agree on how to eradicate polio. And so you saw for the first time scientists from the United States working with scientists from Russia at the United Nations and elsewhere. And for the first time, we solved the issue of polio. And so I think when we have a common vision and a common purpose, we can really engage and get a lot done.
And Ray, I would just add, I mean, in the fall of 2021, US LNG producers engaged in 4 long-term contracts with China and Chinese energy companies. The United States is going to be the largest exporter of LNG to China by the end of 2022, early 2023. So we do see a lot of interesting engagement and cooperation, both at the, you know, especially at the, you know, private company front here in the United States, but also with, you know, state-owned national energy companies in China. So I think that's not a subject that gets a lot of attention, but it is an area where there's, you know, tremendous trade and engagement.
Well, thank you. This has been great. We're exactly at 4 o'clock, so we have to end the meeting on time, which is one of the council's core competencies, beginning and ending on time. and when we get back in person, there'll be receptions with beer and wine, which is another core competency, but we have to put that off for now. So I want to thank everybody for joining us, especially thanks Earl and Carolyn for their knowledge and their sharing their time, and for the team putting it together, and for all the members attending and asking great questions. Thank you very much, everybody. Have a good afternoon.
Thank you. Thanks, Jim.
Thank you, Jim. Bye. Thank you, everyone.